listening to WMNH 95.3.
The commander to the supreme leader, Mezzo coming down.
Welcome, everybody. Here we go. Happy Friday. It is that time again. Matt Connerton unleashed, and we are live from the studios of WMNH 95.3 FM in glorious downtown Manchester, New Hampshire. Also on Comcast Channel 6 if you're in Manchester, and hello to all of our online listeners across the nation. And around the globe, you can go to my website, mattconnerton.com, for all of your live streaming options, social media links, contact info, show archives, etc., etc. Today is Friday, October 6, 2023. Friday, of course, my favorite day of the week here at WMNH because it's my long day here, and I do love it so. I do this show from 4 to 6 p.m., and then I'm back tonight, 8 to 11 p.m. for Retro Spectrum Radio with Paul E.C. I have the honor and privilege of being one of Paul's co-hosts on that show, along with DJ Steve, and you never know who else might be showing up. So we have a great time on Friday nights, so it is another Friday. And we have a very busy show here on this program for you today. We opened with a couple of brand new tracks, the new Sepsis single, Romance and Reality, a great track, really love that. And then we also played new track, Abyss, by our friend Grimrock, who lives in Pennsylvania, and we had him on the show, had a great discussion. I really like his sound, too. And then we threw in a little bit of Jerry and the Scumbags as well. There's a bass player on that track. I think his name's Matt Covington. Boy, I'll tell you what, he really lays down the groove. So we figured I'd throw that in too, because why not? It's Friday. So we've got that. We've also got, at any moment, we're going to be hearing from our friend Charles Richardson from Florida. He's got a very special announcement he would like to make here live on the show. So always look forward to talking with Charles. And then a little bit later in the hour, because it is Friday, we have Eric Pilcher's A Classic Film Review. And today the subject is The Exorcist, William Friedkin's The Exorcist, the original, not the new one that just came out, of course, because it's a classic film review. So the original Exorcist, although Eric is working on a separate podcast, which will be up, not here on WMNH, but it'll be up at mattconnerton.com. But we'll keep you posted on that regarding the new Exorcist film. But this week, today, the classic film review is The Exorcist. So that'll be coming up at about quarter of. And then in the second hour today, we have some guests. His first time on the show, actually, Sebastian Fuentes will be joining us, and he's going to be bringing a few people that he works with as well. They are immigration activists, and they do other things, too. They're part of Rights and Democracy, the organization that one of the organizations that Jenny's been working with on healthcare. But Sebastian Fuentes, and again, he's bringing a few people with him. They're going to come in and talk about immigration rights in the second hour. And if you're a longtime listener, you know that's an issue that I'm pretty passionate about. So really looking forward to meeting them. I feel like I already know Sebastian because I went to friend him on Facebook, and it's like, oh, we have all these mutual friends. We have like 60 mutual friends, but we don't know each other yet. So that will change today in the second hour. So really looking forward to that as well. So we have a very, very full show today. Which I'm happy about. But if you'd like to get in with a call, you can. We've got a little bit of time. 603-250-6007. 603-250-6007 is the studio line. You can also text me at 617-917-4476. I'm on social media at Matt Connerton. You can email me, matt@mattconnerton.com. And of course, you can interact and opine in the Facebook live chat. But the best thing to do so that we can hear and enjoy your dulcet tones is to give us a call at 603-250-6007, 603-250-6007. Let's go ahead and say hello to everybody in the Facebook live chat. Speaking of the Facebook live chat, we've got a busy chat room. Eric Pilcher, we were just talking about Eric, first one in there. He says, hello, everyone. Hello. Isaac Banks, who is from, if I remember correctly, Greensboro, North Carolina. Isaac Banks says, good afternoon, Matt Connerton. Hi, hashtag Jen Coffee. Good afternoon. Good afternoon, hashtag Eric Pilcher. Charles Richardson is in the Facebook live chat and says, greetings to the gathering of the Unleashed Live. Oh, I like that. Gathering of the Unleashed Live. Live in all caps, which is good. Isaac Banks says, good afternoon, hashtag Abby Baldwin. How are you doing? And I was wondering if you like to meet me at the Sunshine Club at St. Pius Catholic Church. Is fall dance inside? If you wear your costume, please come if you meet me inside. Maybe you can give me a ride home. Event starts 7 to 9 p.m. I see what you're doing, Isaac Banks. You want to make sure you're trying to arrange things with hashtag Abby Baldwin so you have a ride home later. I get it. That's smart. That's very smart. And I believe this is Charles on the phone. Hi, Charles.
Hey, Matt. What's going on?
What's going on with you?
I want to say thank you for giving me this time and opportunity to the forum to go ahead and make my important announcement.
Yes.
That I have. So I have been doing a lot of thinking about my life and my life direction and things that I would like to do and accomplish. So as of today, me and Isaac Banks are going to be gathering there in Greensboro and forming a new hot teen band called the Hashtags.
That's remarkable. I think that's amazing.
It is. It's absolutely remarkable. I might as well go ahead and I've been sucked in to this like the Lord of the Ring. You know, the ring is the Greensboro is the ring and it's calling me. It's been calling me. So I have now decided to answer it.
Now, let me ask you this, Charles, because you're there in Florida. Is there any chance you might be able to get Lou Pearlman out of prison and he can manage you guys?
Actually, because our songs are so powerful, me and Isaac Banks, mm-hmm. we have the ability to go ahead and actually play a song to numb all the security officers that are on duty. We'll just take the keys mm-hmm. and unlock it, and we'll just be able to walk them right out of there while the songs are playing.
So you've already got a plan. That's remarkable.
We already have it all settled down. That's why it's such a big announcement. What's going on is after a 7-month hiatus, I am returning back to my show, the Charles Richardson Show.
Excellent.
We are doing it Monday and Wednesday, back to the same time slot, 8 to 10 p.m.
Okay.
No Friday. We're going to do it 2 hours. We're going to incorporate everything that we've done before, like the memes that we've done on Facebook. We're going to keep doing that as part of the show. Alyssa will still on the show with good news.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to try to have it more segment-based and topic-based. But a lot of it's going to be dealing with, a lot of mental health.
Yeah.
At least we're going to try to incorporate some of it because, in reality, I struggle with it on almost a daily basis, and it really depends on what it is
mm-hmm.
That's going on in my life. So I'll definitely go ahead and bring that up for a conversation. We'll still try to hit the hot topics of the day in the news. We'll still try to do some entertainment reports, and nothing can compete with Easy G's entertainment reports. But we'll try to go ahead and honor him in that way.
Charles, if I could just interject because you mentioned Easy G, if you would like to, because I'm so excited about your new show or getting the show back on the air, I think it's phenomenal. If you would like to, because I'm nothing if not magnanimous, I would allow you to sort of steal quote unquote Easy G away from me if you feel that he would enhance your show and you'd really like Easy G to be a part of your newly launched show, you can have him. I'm offering him to you, which is hard for me to, it would be hard for me to give him up, but I really want you to succeed, and I think he can help you tremendously with his entertainment report.
Matt, I appreciate you being so half honest with me because you and I both know we've chatted And you basically have begged me to take EZJ off your hands. Well, that, please, well, get, well, please, I don't want to deal with him anymore.
Well, I was,
his boringness on the phone. I mean, literally, you've expressed to me many times.
No.
Please, Charles, hurry back with your show and take him off my hands.
Well, I was.
I will attempt to see what I can do. Maybe if we're having a slow show, EZG can make it that much slower. That can always be an enhancement, I guess.
Yeah, I was just trying to get you motivated. I thought the opportunity to work with a talent the level of EZG, I thought that would really motivate you to get back to your show.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, I always would willing to work with a talent almost as much of a German cockroach. I would love to have that opportunity. That would be great. I'll definitely take it. Definitely take it into consideration. I will definitely sleep on it and sit on it and do other things on it. But we'll take it as it goes.
All right.
But yeah, Monday 8 p.m. That's when we start Eastern Time. It's still going to be a call-in show. It'll still be on Facebook. It'll be on my different platforms. I believe also you said it's okay to be back on the IPM Nation platform.
Mm-hmm.
So I believe we're still going to be on that.
Yes.
Okay, just making sure. I was double checking on that. Not to put you on the spot or anything.
Yeah.
So we're coming back. We're going to be doing it, and it's me and Alyssa. We may have some chime-ins from old cast members like Karen. Maybe Mo may join us. Matt D again may join us. We may even have somebody who made a very, very, very big phone call the last show, Tony D, maybe coming on as well.
Not the guy from Michigan, though, I hope.
Who's that? We have no idea who that rapist is.
Oh, yeah.
I have no idea anyway, who that is.
Okay.
I don't want to even know.
I shouldn't have brought him up.
See, there's been some snafu co-hosts in my day.
Yeah.
You know, I had one that decided to go ahead and drink too heavily and threatened to burn down my house if he that was fun. And there was another one who basically said two words the whole show.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, we had that guy who, let's put it this way, I was in a bad need to bounce things off of people, and just his didn't bounce off very well. He needed to be ousted.
By the way, I think Isaac Banks shot you down on the idea of doing music with him. He said in the chat room, hashtag Charles Richardson, that's extraordinary, but I appreciate it. But I did my own videos myself with my cell phone. So I guess...
I stand corrected. I think that was a dream I had. Because I listen to Matt's show so many times, and I'm here in Greensboro, North Carolina. I think I was just imagining that I was teaming up with you in Greensboro, North Carolina. I think it was just a dream. I'm sorry, Isaac. I did not mean... Please disregard everything I said about that.
By the way, Eric Pilcher said, Tony D, that will drive up the views. I think he's being sarcastic. But
I know the backstory with Tony D.
He's
and everything
a
like that.
Polarizing
he's,
figure.
He's apologized to me and everything. I know what, you know, we had our own thing. I know he's got other issues with other people.
No, he did. He did apologize, though.
This is the one thing I can't go ahead. This is the one thing I can't go ahead and worry about. I can't worry about what other people have done with other people.
Oh, I know.
It's only what they've done to me.
I know exactly what you mean. Otherwise, it would be hard to work with anybody. If everybody's upset somebody at some point, so no, I totally get it.
Yeah, I think I may because of that I may have upset one of my former affiliates, who I won't mention here because I think because of my possible association with Tony D, I may have upset one of my affiliates. But you know what? I can't worry about that anymore. I can't worry about what other people think of me or think of my opinions. My opinions are my own opinions, and that's what everybody has a right to. And that's what I want coming across this show is you have an open forum, just like on your show, Matt,
mm-hmm.
to go ahead and call in, and you want to disagree, you go ahead and disagree with me.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to put you down. I'm not going to throw you over the bus or call you names. You have your opinion. I have my opinion.
and that's the way it's going to be. You want to go ahead and have an honest debate about it? Let's do it.
Right, right.
And, of course, that's going to be on several different subjects. Politics is going to be one thing. It's probably not going to be on my show unless it is something that affects us directly, immediately. I know everything that goes on in politics does affect us one way or another, more pressing issues of things that would affect us immediately. Educational system with our kids, money system, or rent, anything like that that's affecting us is definitely something that will be brought to the forefront.
Right, right. Okay. Well, very good. So
thank you again for allowing me to go ahead and make that announcement. Hopefully everybody can tune in. I'd appreciate it. If not, that's understandable. But try to tune in and give us a listen and see what you think.
All right. Well, very good, Charles. Congratulations and welcome back.
Thank you. Have a good day.
All right. You too. Bye-bye. All right. That was Charles Richardson from Florida discussing the return of the Charles Richardson Show starting next week. So I just figured he'd be back eventually. It's hard to just, I understand, he had to take a break and sometimes life gets in the way, but once you've, I don't know how many people can walk away from it and actually stay away from it. You know what I mean? So, let's see, we have a call. We'll grab this. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
Holy smokes.
Have you been...
I don't know what's going on right now.
Hope you haven't
I think
been,
that I might be possessed by a demon.
Well, that's appropriate because coming up in just a little bit, we have Eric Pilcher's review of The Exorcist.
You don't say.
Yes.
Hey, if you... I was tuned in early in the show, but then I had to go do something. I just came back. Have you reported yet that Iowa... has knuckled, the Iowa Democratic Party has knuckled under to DNC and the DNC, the Democratic National Committee, and Joe Biden, and is not going to report any of the caucus results until Super Tuesday?
Really? I didn't know that. See, I didn't know that was a thing. I only knew about, of course, the pressure that they've been putting on New Hampshire to not go first and to let South Carolina go first. I didn't know that they were pressuring Iowa. So Iowa is giving in on this and they're not going to report who won the Iowa caucus or any results until Super Tuesday. Is that what you're saying?
Right. From what I've read, and maybe Eric can briefly, because I plan to be brief, if you believe that or not, I do, can chime in. But from what I read today, they will hold the caucuses in January, but they will not report the results, which, since they have so much trouble reporting results, it seems like...
Yeah.
The Iowa caucus is ridiculous. The stuff you read in the history books is made up. In 1976, Jimmy Carter did not win the Iowa caucuses. A non-committed delegate won overwhelmingly. He just came in a distant second. Nobody even reported on the Iowa caucuses in 1976.
But
it wasn't until 1980 when the press thought that Teddy Kennedy would duplicate his brother and take New Hampshire in 1980 that they started building up the Iowa caucus.
By the way, Eric...
Fort became something big.
Eric is in the chat room, and he said that's true. He just validated what you said. Yeah, I can't. That's so bizarre. So they're gonna have.
Why is it bizarre?
That they're gonna they're not gonna report the results until Super Tuesday. That's just bizarre.
Well, the results, you saw what happened the last time. It was that they're even allowed to be part of the United States is beyond me.
So you don't think Iowa? So you would favor Iowa, perhaps entering into a secessionist endeavor like we have here in New Hampshire with NHExit? Maybe
not at all. I believe that states like Montana, the Dakotas, Wyoming, Idaho, I guess Colorado is a little more civilized. They should be given back to the First Nations, Native Americans, indigenous peoples. I do believe that.
Oh.
I don't think Wyoming should have two Senate seats when it's only got like 450,000 people.
Because
and they're all cranks anyways.
Well,
I mean, Dick Cheney's daughter is a fascist, yet because the modern MAGA GOP is literally insane, she's touted as some type of, you know, I don't know what she's touted as, but it's not her true fascist self.
Eric Pilcher says, I mean, with more time, maybe it can be more than an more organized than a Tijuana donkey show. My good. Well, I've never been to one. I don't know that I've ever heard that expression. But, yeah, Eric has talked about the Iowa caucus in the past and how, you know, how just strange it is and very disorganized.
Yes, and it's absurdity created by the press.
But why?
I
don't understand, though. Why does Biden and the DNC, why do they care? I mean, he's a sitting incumbent. It's not like he's going to lose the Iowa caucus, is he? I mean, is that even possible?
Because he is a lousy jerk. I could use stronger language. I consider him a warmonger. I believe Cy Hirsch that he did blow up the pipeline. I think he's a reckless duck. I don't think he's like a Dr. Strangelove type, because in the movie Dr. Strangelove, which Eric ought to review, we had already done it on my show, they didn't have any senile characters. But let me be brief. New Hampshire Democratic Party apparatchiks are meeting today, but they're hiding behind the thing that I talked about the other day. They're saying, well, we really can't do anything because the Secretary of State will not run a primary just for the Democrats.
Yeah.
So I guess we have the Democratic primary in New Hampshire, and you have to this, I guess, today the 6th, or is it the 7th?
Today is October 6th, 2023.
Yeah, if you want to change your party in New Hampshire, I think today's the last day to do it. And so I guess, you know, we can vote. But the DNC, and they've been threatening this for years since I was a kid, that, oh, if you go too early, we'll just take away your delegates. But you have to understand, and what people never understood, like in 2016, everybody was – I'd like to use the B word, but we'll just use the C word, complaining that, oh, well, Bernie Sanders, you know, racked up 60% of the vote and he only got a third of the delegates. Well, that's because in the primary state of New Hampshire and I think other states, it's just a third of the delegates are up when it comes to the vote. Mm-hmm. Then there was a second round, which I attended, and I voted for two people, including Chris Pappas, who's now our congressman, who were for Hillary, and Donna Soucy, who's the president of the Senate. She's a state senator. I know these people because they live in New Hampshire, right? You know the congressman. Senators know you by the first name, even though you're a schlub like me.
Right.
And then Joyce Craig asked me to vote for a couple Bernie people.
Mm-hmm.
And Joyce Craig is our mayor, for the people that don't know that. And she wasn't mayor then, though, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But so I did that because, you know, they were good people, and I've always liked Bernie Sanders.
Mm-hmm.
So that was the second round. So that's another third of the delegates. And then the party insiders meet for the last, you know, the last round. So all this idea about, you know, people just don't – it's such a strange system, and people don't even understand it. But I have to admit, I've been following it since 1972, and until 2016, I didn't understand it.
Right.
Until I fully participated in it, you know?
Yeah.
But Eric has told us what it's like to participate in the Iowa caucuses, and it's like, you know, Alice through the looking glass, you know?
Yeah, it's
in New Hampshire, you vote.
Eric, on a couple of different occasions on the show, Eric has very patiently tried to explain it to me, and I still don't get it.
You know, and I've watched it on TV because, you know, they've really given it heavy coverage. Before 1980, everything, the 70, 68, 72, and 76, New Hampshire, because that was the first. Nobody cared about the caucuses. There were caucuses in Alaska and another state in 1980, even before Iowa. But they decided Iowa, I guess, you know, you could fly people in from Chicago, which is, you know, the second city.
Right.
But a lot of what we think of as democracy is just, you know, fiction in a way. But not saying we don't have a democracy. It's just befuddling. But so if we vote, if you vote in the Democratic primary, likely your vote won't count. But you have the chance to go to the second round as a registered Democrat. It's just most people don't know about it.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can vote. You know, people get up and they're running for to the convention. What are the delegates?
Delegates, yeah.
Yeah, they're running for state delegates and stuff. And I've also covered an electoral college vote where candidates, I was covering Liz Warren when she was running for senator for Yahoo News.
Mm-hmm.
And I went to Lowell High School, and they had the election for the electors, the Democratic electors. You know, they'd get up and they'd give a speech. And then this group of people, these insiders from the – but, they, you know, when I say insiders from the Mass Democratic Party or the New Hampshire Party, in the second round, it's actually, you know, there was Chris Pappas, who was the executive counselor, which is just under governor in New Hampshire. Very few states have an executive counselor for the people from out of the state.
Right.
So he was there, but I'm there too, you know.
Yeah.
The Hamer, my friends the Hamers were there before they became elected like state rep and to the school board. So, and when I was at the thing for the electors, they just seemed like activists and like no average people. You know, when the Electoral College was created, it was supposed to be people for like Thomas Jefferson, like type of people were supposed to be part of it.
Right.
But, you know, just turned out to be the equivalent of whatever Joe Sixpack was back then, or John Q. Public, or Mary. We don't have names, quaint names like that for women since the sexual revolution, but
oh yes,
you know, well,
that ruined everything.
But you know, activists, if you are active and you aren't nuts and you actually work hard and are useful, you know, you can become part of a party system.
Yeah,
but we'll see. You know, today they're voting about the primary. But I highly doubt that Ray Buckley, who's the head of the New Hampshire Democrat Party, will cede the New Hampshire primary, you know?
Yeah, no, this is something there seems to be unity on. Ray Buckley and our governor, Chris Sununu, our Republican governor, certainly seem to be united on this, that we are not budging. And as I like to paraphrase Charlton Heston, you'll have to pry the first in the nation primary from our cold, dead hands.
Well, you know, let's hope it doesn't come to that, because so far we don't have our own nuclear weapons. Though, you know, Mel Thompson, the reactionary governor from the 70s, did try, but so he could wage war against the state of Maine over the lobster pets.
Yes.
But the other story is Mediaite says Robert F. Kennedy has a big announcement Monday, which now everything makes sense. You know, he never intended even to run as a Democrat.
Is he going to run as an independent? I heard something about the Green Party, but that can't be true. I assume he's going to run as an independent, right?
Well, the Green Party is a party that would appeal to somebody like me, you know, or Bernie Sanders.
Well, that's what I mean.
Not appeal to the MAGA nuts that he's been courting.
Well, that's what I mean. That's something I heard, but I heard today, but I said that can't be true. And I know that Cornel West is also now going to be running as an independent. He also he was going to run with the Green Party, but now he's running as an independent as well. I don't agree with him on everything, certainly, but my God, he's difficult to dislike. Cornel West, do you like him? I find it impossible.
Oh yeah, he's a brilliant person.
I find it impossible to dislike him.
Exactly the type of people that get elected president.
Oh no, he has no chance, obviously. But he's one of those people. Like he could just talk and just say everything I disagree with, and I'll still just sit there and be enthralled listening to him. I don't know why. I'm just completely taken with him. That's not an endorsement of him. No one should take it that way. If I were going to endorse anybody, which I don't do, But if I were, I would probably endorse Marianne Williamson because she actually came and talked to us, and she's the most famous person we've ever had on the show. And that carries a lot with me.
I probably will vote for her.
You're probably the second most famous. Everybody knows you. Everybody knows John Hopwood. But
well, you know, you did have Big Steve on the show, and that's just a suit on him. If you actually knew who he was, your Yeti hair would stand on its atavistic end.
Is that true, or are you just kidding?
Oh, it's Friday, and I'll let you determine whether I'm possessed or not.
Oh, well, you did sound a little growly at the beginning there.
I could be speaking in tongues.
You could have rabies, for all I know.
That's true. Okay, take care, Matt.
All right, John. Thank you.
Have a good weekend.
All right, you too. Thanks for the call. All right, that was the great John Hopwood. The only person we've ever really featured, by the way, who speaks in tongues is, I don't have the soundbite. Never mind. I used to have a Paula White on the soundboard speaking in tongues, but I don't see it now. Okay. Well, it kind of ruins that. Oh, that now I found it. Now that the moment's passed. Well, I'll go ahead. Did you catch all that? I wonder if there's an app that you can put on your phone to translate when someone is speaking in tongues. I don't know. Anyway, we are approaching the top of the hour. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to take a quick break. We're going to show some love to our amazing sponsors. And then from there, we are going to go directly into this week's classic film review of William Friedkin's The Exorcist from our friend Eric Pilcher. By the way, before we do that, DJ Steve is in the chat room. Hello. I'll get to see him later for Retro Spectrum Radio. Also, Melanie La Liberty from the great state of Vermont joins us. And JFED, of course, in there as well. I can't remember if I mentioned JFED earlier. And I just want to make sure we don't miss anybody in there. I like to make sure we acknowledge everybody in the chat room. Crystal, our friend from the great state of Illinois. Tom Blanchard, also in the chat, says, did you hear that Donald Trump volunteered to be the temporary Speaker of the House? Yes. It's not going to happen, but yeah, he certainly did. Also, EZG, Eric Gagnon is in the chat room. He says, happy Friday, USOBs. By the way, I was kidding earlier about EZG. I hope everyone knows that. We love EZG. Around here, we only break balls if we like you. If we don't like you, we ignore you. So he's part of the family here. So just so everyone is clear. All right, we're going to take a break. Like I said, we're going to show some love to our sponsors. And then we're going to go right into Eric Pilcher's review of William Friedkin's The Exorcist, the original. And then from there, we will go to hour number two of the show today, and we've got Sebastian Fuentes and some other immigration activists joining us in the second hour for what I'm sure will be a very interesting discussion. So there is plenty more to come. Don't go away.
Come on down to the Hop Knot at 1000 Elm Street, Manchester's premier craft beer and gourmet pretzel bar. Tell us more, Trudy.
We make our dough fresh every day. We make a variety of styles of pretzels and serve craft beer, cocktails, and a few bottles of wine. We do the traditional pretzel, and we have multiple flavors for that. We also do stuffed pretzels, pretzel sandwiches, free dessert pretzels, and pretzel knots.
The Hop Knot in the Brady Sullivan Plaza at 1000 Elm Street.
Bring your kitchen to life with Queen City Cabinetry, located at 87 Elm Street in the historic Sunbeam Mall in Manchester. Open Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. and Saturdays, 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. They can be reached at 603-222-2007 or on the web at queencitycabinetrynh.com. Come see the possibilities. Queen City Cabinetry, another proud sponsor of WMNH.
Clemento's Pizzeria, family friendly, awesome for a date night. Clemento's Pizzeria.
For delivery, call 603-782-8450.
Clemento's Pizzeria, the best pizza in town.
1875 South Willow Street in Manchester, New Hampshire.
Best cocktails around.
Come in as friends and leave as family.
This hour on WMNH is sponsored by CGI Business Solutions, located at 5 Dartmouth Drive in Auburn. They serve all your business needs, including employee benefits planning, corporate design and business administration, investments and wealth management, and customized business insurance solutions. Their phone number is 866-841-4600 or on the web at cgibusinesssolutions.com.
WMNH, rip the knob off.
Somewhere between science and superstition, there is another world. The world of darkness. Nobody expected it. Nobody believed it. And nothing could stop it.
There are no experts. You probably know as much about possession as most priests. Look, your daughter doesn't say she's a demon. She says she's the devil himself.
I'm telling you that that thing upstairs isn't my daughter. Now, I want you to tell me that you know for a fact that there's nothing wrong with my daughter except in her mind. You tell me you know for a fact that an exorcism wouldn't do any good. You tell me that!
The one hope, the only hope, the exorcist.
In order for a horror film to captivate an audience, to have it strike fear into the viewer's soul, what they are seeing has to feel real. Many horror films have attempted this, but few have truly achieved it, and none have captivated, shocked, and still caused an emotional reaction like this week's film over 50 years after its release. Directed by the recently passed on William Friedkin, based off the novel by William Peter Blatty, The Exorcist follows an actress, Chris McNeil, played by Ellen Burstyn, and her daughter Reagan, Linda Blair, in her first role, on location in Georgetown during the filming of a movie that Chris is starring in. During this time, Reagan begins exhibiting behavior that uncovers the pure personification of evil that has taken over her mind, body, and soul. The film also stars Jason Miller, Max von Sydow, and Lee J. Cobb. For Friedkin, taking on this role was a touch of a risk. He had just won Best Director for The French Connection, and because of this, had really his pick of films he could work on next. Our next clip is from one of Friedkin's last public appearances, at the 2023 Turner Classic Movies Film Festival, shortly before his passing. I will warn you, this clip is on the long side, but it shows what made Friedkin great, his humor, and more importantly, he talks about his views taking on this film and what this film means today.
When you look at the Oscar list of nominations, you don't see a lot of films like, frankly, there aren't a lot of films like The Exorcist. I think it stands the test of time in a way that few films do.
You think it stands the test of time? Thank you. No, seriously, that's really important to me to hear that. Thank you very much, because I barely remember the experience.
I'll see if we can poke around and get some memory stirring. But I think one of the things that makes it eternal and is that I always love the fact that you came from a documentary background. And I think this film has a lot of that background reflected in it. It feels real, even though it's fantastic in many ways. It feels like the people are doing real life things. You picked actors who fit the role and who made the role believable. Max von Sydow didn't look like that then. He was much younger. And Ellen Burstyn wasn't that well known. Linda Blair, this was her first film. And yet their mother-daughter relationship, you know, you came across with a very real, believable scenario, because which makes the horror of it. And I don't call this a horror film. I hope you do.
It is a horror film.
All right. You want to call it a horror film? I think it's more than that.
I mean, when it's being described, it's described as a horror film. I never think about what it is per se in terms of its, you know, place in the lexicon, but I thought of it as a great story when I did it. To me, a magnificent story, very powerful.
Mm-hmm. So when you're going about, though, and casting and working with the team that you built, I mean, there's a lot of names associated with this film that you know, really were at the top of their game.
Who's that?
Well, you, number one. You just come off winning the French Connection Best Picture Oscar.
Thank you.
And
I don't think it could be nominated today.
French Connection?
Yeah. No way.
You might be right.
You're supposed to say you're wrong.
No.
Tell him. What's he supposed to say?
I would never say you're wrong. Anyway, what is it about when you're putting a film together? I know that there were choices that you made here that you had to fight for. So what is it about that process that makes you able to fight?
I don't remember having to fight for anything. I had, like, total control. Mm-hmm. I had made The French Connection, which won an Academy Award. Mm-hmm. Best film. Thank you. Thank you. Thanks, Mom. and when that happens, you get your choice on the next film pretty easily. If I hadn't, I would have had to fought for everybody and everything.
So after doing The French Connection, why did you choose The Exorcist?
Because it's a great piece of material.
Okay.
When I read The Exorcist, I thought, I've never seen anything like this. I've never heard of anything like this. I wasn't Catholic, so I didn't know what the hell an exorcism was. Mm-hmm. And it's, you know, it turned out to have some legs. I mean, I think it's a great picture. I honestly do. There aren't a lot of films I can name that are being run at the Chinese theater 50 years later.
Correct.
And that means there's an audience that's interested. I mean, I think if you ran Andy Hardy Goes to Minnesota, you wouldn't have this big an audience.
There are so many ways that this film strikes fear into almost anyone that views it. One way, in my opinion, is they take this wholesome child, Reagan McNeil, and we see her evolve from sweet, innocent child to the epitome of fear, someone possessed by the devil himself. Our next two clips show the differences in Reagan. First, Reagan and her mother play with an Ouija board. In this scene, we hear the relationship that they have. But there's an underlying sense of tension when Reagan brings up what is thought to be then an imaginary friend named Captain Howdy that gives us a sinister feeling. And then, in the early stages of possession, a psychiatrist interviews Reagan. These two clips are a great contrast to personalities. First, Reagan is playful and full of life. Then, when a demonic presence takes over, she becomes lifeless, dark, and...
Hey, where'd this come from?
I found it.
Where?
Closet.
Huh. You been playing with it?
Yep.
You know how?
I'll show you. You need two.
No, you don't. I do it all the time.
Oh, yeah? Well, let's both put the fit.
You really don't want me to play, huh?
No, I do. Captain Howdy said no.
Captain who?
Captain Howdy.
Who's Captain Howdy?
You know, I make the questions and he does the answers.
Oh, Captain Howdy, yeah, I see.
Nice.
Oh, I bet he is.
Here, I'll show you. Captain Howdy, do you think my mom's pretty? Captain Howdy? Captain Howdy, that isn't very nice.
And now, the psychiatrist speaks with Reagan and gets some disturbing, albeit short, answers.
When I touch your forehead, open your eyes. Are you comfortable, Reagan?
Yes.
How old are you?
12.
Is there someone inside you?
Sometimes.
Who is it?
I don't know.
Is it Captain Howdy?
I don't know.
If I ask him to tell me, will you let him answer?
No.
Why not?
I'm afraid.
If he talks to me, I think he'll leave you. Do you want him to leave you?
Yes.
I'm speaking to the person inside of Reagan now. If you are there, you too are hypnotized and must answer all my questions. Come forward and answer me now.
Anytime we speak about the devil, it's almost second nature that we have to reference God. As I said earlier this week on Matt Connerton Unleashed, without good, there cannot be evil. It's yin and yang. You need both elements. In order for the demon Pazuzu to be stricken from Reagan, two priests are enlisted. Father Karras and Father Marin, Miller and Von Sidio, respectively, to perform an exorcism. Our final two clips are a build to this epic encounter. First, Chris, running out of options to help her daughter, practically begs Father Karras to perform an exorcism on her daughter. And then, in the full throes of possession, while Karras is trying to document evidence so he can get approval for the exorcism, Reagan taunts Karras.
Thank you. Look, I'm only against the possibility of doing your daughter more harm than good.
Nothing you could do could make it any worse.
I can't do it. I need evidence that the church would accept as signs of possession.
Like what?
Like her speaking in a language she's never known or studied.
What else?
I don't know. I'd have to look it up.
I thought you were supposed to be an expert.
There are no experts. You probably know as much about possession as most priests. Look, your daughter doesn't say she's a demon. She says she's the devil himself. Now, if you've seen as many psychotics as I have, you'd realize that's the same thing as saying you're Napoleon Bonaparte. You ask me what I think is best for your daughter. 6 months under observation in the best hospital you can find.
You show me Reagan's double. Same face, same voice, everything. And I'd know it wasn't Reagan. I'd know in my gut. I'm telling you that that thing upstairs isn't my daughter. Now, I want you to tell me that you know for a fact that there's nothing wrong with my daughter except in her mind. You tell me you know for a fact that an exorcism wouldn't do any good. You tell me that!
And now, finally, Karis meets Reagan.
What an excellent day for an exorcism.
You'd like that?
Intensely.
But wouldn't that drive you out of Reagan?
It would bring us together.
You and Reagan.
You and us.
Did you do that? Do it again.
In time.
No, now.
In time. Mirabile dictu, don't you agree?
You speak Latin.
Ego te absolvo.
Quod nomen mihi est?
Bonjour.
Quod nomen mihi est?
La plume de matante.
How long are you planning to stay in Reagan?
Until she rots and lies stinking in the earth. What's that?
Holy water.
You keep it away. It burns! It burns!
Who are you?
This film's legacy speaks for itself. 50 years after its release, it is, in my opinion, and that of many others, the scariest film ever made. It terrifies, shocks, and leaves viewers in stunned disbelief. It has spawned 5 sequels, including Exorcist Believer, that was released today. It has spawned countless imitations, but they have all fell way short of what this film achieved. To do what The Exorcist has done for over 50 years takes a great director in William Friedkin, a compelling story written by William Peter Blatty, a phenomenal cast of Burstyn, Miller, Vincidio, Cobb, and yes, even Linda Blair, and a touch of luck. That is why its legacy endears to this very day. And it is a must-see for any successful Halloween season. I hope you join me next week when we continue our Halloween slate of films with the sequel to Night of the Living Dead, George A. Romero's Dawn of the Dead. For WMNH and Matt Connerton Unleashed, this has been a classic film review with Eric Pilcher.
Dimmi, please. You're not my mother! Dimmi, please.
I am now.
In here with us.
Help
an old altar boy, Father.
Jared! Jared!
Do you know what she did? You kidnapped yourself.
Captain Howard.
In here with us.
Baby, why you do this to me?
Don't you agree?
Let her go!
The power of Christ compels you! The power of Christ compels you!
Come on down to the Hop Knot at 1000 Elm Street, Manchester's premier craft beer and gourmet pretzel bar. Tell us more, Trudy.
We make our dough fresh every day. We make a variety of styles of pretzels and serve craft beer, cocktails, and a few bottles of wine. We do the traditional pretzel, and we have multiple flavors for that. We also do stuffed pretzels, pretzel sandwiches, free dessert pretzels, and pretzel knots.
The Hop Knot in the Brady Sullivan Plaza at 1000 Elm Street.
Bring your kitchen to life with Queen City Cabinetry, located at 87 Elm Street in the historic Sunbeam Mall in Manchester. Open Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. and Saturdays, 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. They can be reached at 603-222-2007 or on the web at queencitycabinetrynh.com. Come see the possibilities. Queen City Cabinetry, another proud sponsor of WMNH.
Clemento's Pizzeria, family friendly, awesome for a date night. Clemento's Pizzeria.
For delivery, call 603-782-8450.
Clemento's Pizzeria, the best pizza in town.
1875 South Willow Street in Manchester, New Hampshire.
Best cocktails around.
Come in as friends and leave as family.
This hour on WMNH is sponsored by CGI Business Solutions, located at 5 Dartmouth Drive in Auburn. They serve all your business needs, including employee benefits planning, corporate design and business administration, investments and wealth management, and customized business insurance solutions. Their phone number is 866-841-4600 or on the web at cgibusinesssolutions.com.
WMNH, rip the knob off. You are listening to WMNH 95.3.
The commander, to the supreme leader, Mezzo Capitan.
Welcome back, everybody, as we are well into hour number two, numero dos of Matt Connerton Unleashed, and we are live from the studios of WMNH 95.3 FM in glorious downtown Manchester, New Hampshire, also on Comcast Channel 6 if you're in Manchester, and hello to all of our online listeners across the nation and around the globe. You can go to my website, mattconnerton.com, for all of your live streaming options, social media links, contact info, show archives, etc., etc. Today is Friday, October 6th. 2023, and I am not alone, my friends. Joining us at the news desk, it's his first time on the show. Sebastian Fuentes is here. How are you, sir?
I'm so excited to be here. Thank you for the invite, mate.
Yes, absolutely. It's wonderful to meet you. I was we were kind of talking off air about how when I friended you on Facebook, I noticed we have a lot of mutual friends, and yet we hadn't met until today. And I know we have another gentleman who's going to be joining us When he arrives. But so we have a lot to talk about. And let me give the numbers, too, if you'd like to enter the discussion that we are about to begin. 603-250-6007 is the studio line, 603-250-6007. You can also text me at 617-917-4476. I'm on social media at Matt Connerton. You can email me, matt@mattconnerton.com. And, of course, you can interact and opine in the Facebook live chat. But the best thing to do so that we can hear and enjoy your dulcet tones is to give us a call at 603-250-6007. Sebastian, tell us, what do you do? What do you do in the space of immigration activism and any other kind of activism that you want to talk about?
Well, yes, Matt. Well, my full-time job, I'm a political director for a nonprofit here in New Hampshire called Rise and Democracy.
Yes.
We're also in New Hampshire and in Vermont. You know, we care a lot about issues of climate, healthcare, education, and housing. But immigration is also at the core of our work. You know, especially it's really personal to me, in New Hampshire, to the community as well. We're trying to amplify the message around negative narrative that mm-hmm. are, you know, floating around. You can read the newspaper every single day. You can watch TV, and there's always going to be a negative message about, you know, the border crisis. There's immigration. We need to shut the borders down. The wall needs to be built. And blah, blah, blah. So it's just we're trying to make sure that we can share the facts. Mm-hmm. We can share, you know, the good information, the real information that I think your listeners and people out there should be aware of.
I feel like and immigration is an issue that I've talked about a lot on the show over the years. And, you know, it's something I you know, kind of I'm kind of centrist overall, I think. But I'm pretty liberal on immigration. I tend to be very, you know, I'm pro-immigration. But I also do feel that we need, and we talked about this a little bit off air too, is we need a drastic overhaul of the immigration system itself. You know, people will often say, well, you know, we have to do this, we have to do that about the border. By the way, I don't have any problem personally with the idea of enhancing border security. A lot of that was done under President Barack Obama, in fact, mm-hmm. In terms of using technology to patrol the border and whatnot. And we have, I don't think we have any, I don't think there's any reason that we as Americans should not expect people to enter the country legally and so forth. But I also think that, you know, it's not as simple as just build a wall. It's we need to deal with the immigration system itself, which is so convoluted and difficult. And, you know, I think we should make it, you know, a huge part of dealing with immigration is I think legal immigration needs to be streamlined in a big way in terms of getting people into the country legally because, you know, we need immigrants. And I think we always need immigrants, but especially right now. When we're, you know, the new jobs numbers today right. were incredible.
Absolutely, yeah.
But what that means is, you know, we're in a situation with, we've been sitting at 3.5% unemployment for so long now. Places don't have enough help. They need help. Well, one way to solve that problem is to bring in more immigrants. So we need immigrants coming into the country. But the asylum system is a mess. You know, we need comprehensive immigration reform, but... And I'm ranting a little bit, Sebastian, but I'll just to kind of put just to add one more thing to that thought, and then I'd like to have you respond to it. But I also think part of the problem politically in this country is that there for both parties, there's actually more money in. Well, let me put it this way: you can raise more money not solving problems. But looking like you're trying to, but not actually solving problems, then you can actually solving problems. As long as a problem remains unsolved, you can continue to raise money off of that issue. And I think immigration is probably the number one best example of that. Nothing really gets solved in any meaningful way. The ball might be moved up or down the field in one direction a little bit, but nothing ever really gets solved. And both Democrats and Republicans get to continue to raise a lot of money off of this issue, and the money go round, as Ray Davies saying about it, just goes on and on and on. And anyway, I kind of ranted a little bit there.
No, but I think you're right on point. You know, that's part of the performative politics that, you know, this nation has lived for since its inception.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'll give you a clear example of how broken the immigration system is right now. There's about 2 million immigration cases pending right now.
Mm-hmm.
But there's only 650 immigration trained judges to handle those 2 million cases.
Wow.
So just think about that. Think about that, you know, when people tell you, you know, you got to become a citizen, you got to do it the right way. Many people are doing it the right way, but it's taking about 15, 12, 20 years to just become a U.S. citizen. So, mm-hmm. Or even just to get a hearing.
Yeah.
So that's where the system is broken. One thing about immigration is every time there's an election, immigration is going to be the top of the list, mm-hmm. the priority for everybody.
Yep.
And immigrants are, I will say, you know, for the comments that I hear from my community, we're just tired of that. You know, every 4 years, you promise us, you know, mm-hmm. heaven on earth. And then once you get elected, nothing happens.
Right.
And sometimes it just gets worse. You know, it also doesn't matter which party it is. You know, we have mm-hmm. seen the one thing that President Trump has done in the past, he has been really outspoken about immigration,
mm-hmm.
To the point of being a little too violent on his how he was handling policies.
Yeah.
But Democrats have done the same thing.
Yeah.
You know, but they were more on the subtle, you know, kind of like quiet mode.
Mm-hmm.
Immigrant community, not just in New Hampshire, but all around the country, we are expecting change. We demand change.
Yeah.
But a more humane system that will benefit not just immigrants, but also American society here in the U.S.
Right.
We have a shortage of, for example, farm workers right now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if I think we should be able to legalize those farm workers already in the country, mm-hmm. working the land. We have a shortage of, you know, health caregivers.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
If you are able to promote that through an immigration system, we can get that not 100% solved, but, you know, a good percentage of them can work on that field that will help the community. But the one thing that we should try to put aside is politics mm-hmm. and just bring the humane side of immigration back to the table. And I think that will be the first step for it.
I think part of that is, I think, though, trying to get people to understand how it benefits themselves. You know, having more immigrants coming into the country, how it benefits all of us. You know, because I think so often in our politics, and it's becoming more divisive, I think, every day. But part of the problem is so people, and you know, you mentioned Trump, and I think he fuels a lot of that. People promote this idea that those of us who grew up here, that we're having something somehow taken away from us because, you know, every time an immigrant comes into the country, somebody else is having something taken away from them, as though it's a zero sum game. When in reality, not only have we been sitting at 3.5% unemployment, nobody has enough help. So obviously you need immigrants to fill those jobs, but also the population is aging.
Mm.
We're kind of screwed because,
we're in trouble.
And it's not just the United States. This is happening in other countries as well. But, the population is aging because, people have stopped having kids. I mean, I'm speaking very broadly and generally, but, So we need people coming into the country who want to come here and work. We need people coming in because we're not making them here. Birth rates have plummeted.
No, yeah.
So we need people coming in. And I think that's a big part of the challenge. It's just getting people to understand we need people coming into the country. So instead of worrying quite so much about building a wall, and listen, again, in principle, I don't have a problem with securing the border. You probably should. But we also need to be doing smart things to fix the immigration system. Eric Pilcher, who's a contributor to the show, in fact, he does our film reviews. He's a conservative. Mm-hmm. And he came up with the idea, because we were discussing this on the show one day. I do a weekly segment with him. He's, you know, I'm kind of a center left. He's conservative, but we have really great discussions. His idea was, for one thing, take the visa system and just simplify it, make it really simple, and make it so that we don't have a situation where people are overstaying their visas. You know, make them open-ended or something. Do something to just make that system better, because a lot of people don't know this, but, you know, you've probably had to explain this to people a few times, that's the biggest reason for illegal immigration is people overstaying their visas. That exponentially, I think, outnumbers, I'm not good at math, but I think that's far, far bigger numbers than people actually entering the country illegally, is people just come in here legally and then staying. And as long as they don't run afoul of the law, they're not going to get caught usually. So
I'm just glad you mentioned that, because, you know, I'm upfront and honest about, you know, my immigration status back in the day. Mm-hmm. I came here to the U.S. on a J-1 visa, which is a 3-month student visa.
Okay.
I came here to work at a ski area because they needed the work. They needed the, you know, the workers. Otherwise, the ski area won't be able to function. And I decided to ever stay.
Yeah.
I decided because, hey, look at this country is awesome. This country is giving me a different opportunity to be better. I don't want to go back home. So I stay. Fortunately, you know, I did the whole lengthy process of becoming a U.S. citizen.
Good.
In 2016, I became a U.S. citizen. So, but I also understand that that was me back then. There's almost 14 million people in that situation right now.
Mm-hmm.
When you mentioned about, you know, our state is aging, one clear example is what's happening in the North Country of New Hampshire. All those ski areas, all those fancy hotels and resorts, we depend on foreign workers to come here for 3 months, 4 months to be able to function,
mm-hmm.
to be able to those ski lifts to operate, to be able to those restaurants have buster service, dishwashers, prep cooks. If it wasn't for that work, many of them will be suffering right now.
Yep.
And one comment that I hear often is like, we need more visas given to these folks so they can come and work. So, yeah, so I'm pretty upfront and honest about, you know, I was undocumented for some time here in the U.S.,
mm-hmm.
here in New Hampshire, which is even more difficult than being an undocumented fella in Florida or Texas. I think I did it because, you know, maybe this might sound like a stereotype, but the American dream is real.
Mm-hmm.
The American dream is real. And this is the country of opportunities. And if it wasn't for that, I wouldn't be here speaking in front of you right now.
Exactly.
You know?
Yeah, exactly. Well, and someone like you who wants to come here and as a, whether it be as a student or for a specific job or whatever it is, you know, why wouldn't we want you to stay?
Right.
You know, that's why it's weird to me that there's even such a thing as a 3-month visa. You know what I mean? Like there should be it should be longer. I think. I mean, 3 months.
There's a 3-month visa. There's a whole year visa. There's, you know, the fiance visa. There's the S visa that I call it, the sneaky snitches.
Yeah.
If you witness a crime anywhere in the world and
yeah.
you want to report it, the U.S. will protect you, and that's the type of visa you can have. The S visa.
Really?
Oh,
I didn't know that was a thing.
There's one. You know, we get the, you know, the Melania Trump visa that you're an Einstein, you're amazing at your specific job, you can get a visa.
Yeah.
The fiance visa. We got so many. It's the whole alphabet of visas.
Yeah.
You know, the process is lengthy, it's expensive, and sometimes it damages your mental health.
Oh,
not
yeah.
Just
no
for
doubt.
Your family and your kids, but just think about it. You know, if I'm in the process of becoming a citizen or just getting a green card, I can go out to work or I can go to the grocery store. I can't be stopped. And that might be the last time I see my family,
mm-hmm.
you know, and that's just the experience of many.
Yeah.
Including myself back in the day.
Yeah. Do you have any hope? Something that I've talked about a lot on the show over the years, although it hasn't come up lately, really, but it, just because it hasn't been in the news, but DACA, Deferred Action Childhood Arrival Program, I think should have been. Well, actually, not only should it have been codified into law by Congress, you know, obviously Obama did an executive order on that, which I fully agreed with. And I know a lot of what Obama did, some of it was controversial in terms of immigration. But DACA, definitely something I agree with. And, you know, listen, even a lot of conservatives agree with it, you know. Some of the most conservative hardliners in Congress on immigration, on that issue specifically, agree with DACA. But I feel that it should be codified permanently into law, and I believe that DACA recipients should be granted full citizenship. I do get a little bit of pushback from that from some people who think, well, no, they should still have to apply for citizenship and they should still have to go through a process. But my view of it is, you know, if they were successful in getting DACA status to begin with, you know, why wouldn't you want to make them a citizen? I don't feel that there should be extra hoops for them
right.
to jump through. Certainly, especially at this point, my goodness. But I'm curious to hear your thoughts on that.
You know, I'm thinking that, you know, if you came to this country when you were literally a baby, you know, 6, 7 month, 8 month old, and America is all you know,
mm-hmm.
You know, your neighborhood, your family, where you went to school, where you, you know, grew up, when you went to college, in America is your country, that you should be given the advantage of being able to become a U.S. citizen.
Yeah.
They don't know any better. You know, when you're 6 months old,
right.
you depend on your moms and dads, you know, pretty much rules. And
yeah.
So I think that needs to be transformed. But that also highlights the problem that we have in the U.S. immigration system, that the system is built on racist policies. You know, one clear example, when it happened, the conflict in Ukraine, you know, and the borders were closed because of COVID,
mm-hmm.
The border was open for Ukrainian citizens, which, in all their rights, you know, they're allowed to come here because they're seeking refugee.
Yeah.
Because the country is getting, you know, it's a huge conflict. So when you approach, when you are a border station to seek protection from the U.S. government, if you are a Ukrainian citizen, it will take you literally 8 hours to be able to get all your stuff done and come in and be safe. If you're a citizen from Venezuela, Honduras, El Salvador, coming to the same border station,
mm-hmm.
it will take about 3 to 4 years.
Wow.
So why is the difference? Is the difference because of skin color? The difference because of nationality? The difference because the intensity of the conflict in one country and not the other one? How do we know that? How can we analyze that? So I think there's so much work needs to be done in there. But honestly, I don't know if either administration, like Republican or Democrat, have the solution. It has been a conversation that many has had for the last 50, 60 years. And nobody knows how to fix it.
Right.
And I don't know how to fix it. And I don't think anybody out there listening will know how to have 100% answer of how to reform the immigration system. Work in progress.
Yeah. I think it needs to be simplified. I think a lot of more resources need to be put into, into making it easier to become a citizen, which I know some people don't want to hear. Oh, make it easier. Why would you make it easier? Well, because, again, you know, we need immigrants. But it's frustrating to see, you know, I mean, there are some things that I think, like I said, I think there's more money raised off of not solving problems than solving
Absolutely.
Them. But I also think too, it's like, there are some things, well, actually, oh, let's grab this call. Our friend Ron is on the line. He probably has a question. Hey, Ron, how you doing?
Good, guys. How you doing?
Good. Welcome.
I think, I know, and everybody, I'm sure, would agree, is the language barrier is tough. It goes beyond tough. It's hard for people to employ people with language barriers, and it's hard for people with language barriers to seek in these employment, this employment and jobs. So, the language barrier is part of the problem. How much of the problem, I don't know, but it is.
Yeah.
So I guess that was it.
Okay, Ron. All right. I appreciate the call.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Ron does bring up an interesting point. I mean, although obviously there are ways to, people come here and they learn English.
Mm-hmm.
Some more quickly than others. But obviously, you know, if you're an employer and you're employing people who don't speak English, you're figuring something out, right?
Yeah, you have to be creative. You know, there's some jobs that don't require you to be in front of public. But it's also one thing that I experienced, because I also working in the hospitality business for 16 years before doing what I'm doing right now. When we have employees that will come from different countries that didn't speak the language, there was this natural way of like trying to connect with that individual
mm-hmm.
in one way or another.
Yeah.
You know, either though that the manager will try to learn a few words about the language of that person, or that person will, you know, or get a training manual in their own language.
Yeah.
And then many companies are now trying to include that kind of language into their like employee handbooks and training processes. So I think how some businesses are doing it is changing.
Mm-hmm.
Language is definitely a problem, but I think one biggest problem is compassion.
Yeah.
You know, and understanding that, you know, if I was an American fella going to a different country and I don't speak, you know, German or French, how would that be different?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think it's in the same. But no, Mr. Ron make a good point. You know, language can be a barrier, but one thing that we can do maybe is ask our local officials to, you know, like fund some programs that will be able to not only teach English to foreign workers, but also languages to locals.
Right.
So they can build community as well. So
right. Crystal, our friend from Illinois in the chat room, says, I think there are a lot of people who make a lot of money off of the immigrants becoming American citizens. It takes years and a lot of cash. Many can't afford it. I think that's an area that needs to be looked at, make it easier and less expensive, maybe streamline the process or something. Yeah, like you were pointing out earlier, it's very expensive.
It is very expensive. Let me tell you something, a personal experience. When I tried to file for, you know, to become a U.S. citizen, you know, I filed my paperwork online here in Manchester, actually. They used to have an office right here in Canal Street. My paperwork went from New Hampshire to Albany, New York, went to Texas, then went to Albany, Vermont, back to Manchester, to Bedford, back to St. Albans, and back to New Hampshire. So the process was that, and that was 6 years, though. Six years. You know, the back then it was USCIS, but now it's, you know, Homeland Security. We're able to... streamline that so you can track where your paperwork is.
Yeah.
But it cost me about $6,500 just to file all that because I had to hire a lawyer that I could not find in New Hampshire because my lawyer was in Iowa.
Oh, yeah.
So, okay. You know, trying to have an immigration lawyer that it's, you know, in the Midwest to do my work here in New Hampshire was extremely, that increased my anxiety. You know what I mean?
Yeah. No doubt. Frank, if you want to just, if you want to sit on that in there, and there's headphones there for you, and the volume is, if you need it, I don't know, how's the volume in those? Good?
Welcome, Frank.
Let me bring your mic up there, and joining us in studio on the couch, what's your name?
Hey, everyone, Frank Kinnack. I'm the policy director with the ACLU of New Hampshire.
Oh, very good. Welcome.
We have the professionals now.
Yes. Very good. Welcome, Frank.
Thanks for having us.
Absolutely. And let me give the studio line if anyone wants to chime in on the discussion we're having, 603-250-6007, 603-250-6007. Well, Frank, tell us about yourself and what you do at the ACLU.
So I work with the ACLU of New Hampshire, and I focus mostly on our public policy, both at the federal or at the state level and at the local level. So we're doing a lot of work around immigration and coordination with Sebastian and a number of great advocates, working on a lot of drug policy reform and criminal legal reform, obviously working to protect access to abortion care, LGBTQ rights, et cetera. So a lot of work cut out for us.
Yeah, no doubt. Now, do the two of you gentlemen do a lot of work together, I assume?
Fortunately, we do.
We're always connected. You know, the SLU has been a partner of the immigrant community for so long.
Yeah.
You know, every time I had an issue that, you know, in a legal matter that I don't understand because, you know, that's not my field, there's always a ACLU fella that can help us out. And I will say that relationship within the immigrant community and the ACLU has been really, really strong here in New Hampshire.
Yeah. Excellent. Frank, can you tell us about what are some of your concerns with immigration? And you're coming into this at a point where Sebastian and I have been talking, and I've been kind of vented to him a little bit about some of my frustrations about how, you know, we can't seem to get comprehensive immigration reform in this country and things like that. And we kind of talked about some of my cynical ideas about why I think it's so impossible. But I don't know. I mean, can you give us some thoughts on what we should be doing to fix the immigration system? I've been saying, and I say this a lot on the show, that we need immigrants and that for a few different reasons. We need to be actively bringing immigrants into the country. But I also think that we need to massively overhaul the immigration system that we have so we can bring people into the country legally, but more quickly. And that will, of course, cut down on illegal immigration if we make it easier to actually get into the country. And I think we should simplify the visa system and all this kind of stuff. But if you want to give us your thoughts.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I think another big concern of us with us on the immigration front is the trying to match the rhetoric with the reality. And mm-hmm. So what we've heard for a long time now is this quote unquote crisis that's brewing on the northern border that we are quote unquote being invaded. And, you know, Sebastian and I and a number of advocates had the opportunity to go up to the North Country a few weeks ago. And what we saw couldn't be different from that reality. You know, we met with business leaders, we talked with other community members, and we really asked them foundational questions. What are the things that are making your lives less safe on a daily basis up here?
Mm-hmm.
And what we heard had nothing to do with the rhetoric around immigration. We heard that there's a need for housing, that there's a need for living wage, that there's a need for broader broadband access. We asked even, you know, during COVID, what it was like, were kids able to get access to school? Because obviously during COVID, kids needed to have access to the internet. And they told us that a huge proportion of their students were unable to get education during COVID because there's no broadband access. So this is 2023, or at the time, 2020 and 2021 America, where kids were getting no access to school because we couldn't figure out how to get broadband access to a whole swath of the North Country.
That's incredible. Are there still people on dial-up up there?
I don't know dial-up, but there's no access.
I don't think there's even dial-up. You know, many kids, and I can say even as south as Littleton, Lancaster, they had to go to like the local Dunkin' Donuts with a Chromebook to be able to have internet.
Wow.
To be able to attend virtual classes. So, you know, that's the reality of, you know, rural New Hampshire, I guess. Mm-hmm. And then especially, you know, Northern Coos County and Grafton.
Wow. So what is, I haven't paid that much attention to, in terms of the rhetoric around the northern border here. I mean, what are the concerns that you're hearing from people?
So so last legislative session, obviously, was a budget cycle. And so the governor put out a request in his initial proposal to the legislature to create a, quote, Northern Border Alliance.
Okay.
And so the rhetoric was behind this was that we, again, have this crisis at the border, that we need to expand our policing and surveillance capacities at the border to address this crisis. And so we started asking, you know, basic questions that we thought legislators should be asking before they appropriated the requested $1.4 million. And that was, is there, in fact, a crisis? Are people crossing the border without authorization? And when we actually dug into the details, we could provide, you know, the state had no evidence that this was actually happening. So we heard the commissioner of safety actually testified before Congress that this was happening, that people were coming over the border without authorization in New Hampshire. And so we sent Freedom of Information Request Act requests to the governor's office and to the Department of Safety asking, provide us this evidence. You know, you're making these claims, provide us the evidence. And they actually responded that they have no responsive document. And so,
even though he testified under oath in Congress, there was a crisis, and all of a sudden there's none here.
Wow.
Yeah. Yep, and so now we're actually engaged in litigation with the federal government, with CBP trying to get access to see if they actually have any information through Freedom of Information Act request.
Now, if they don't have the information, if CBP, Border Patrol don't have it, then who has it?
You know,
that's
right,
the scary part of the whole these old dynamics.
Right. Well, why is this happening now, though? Because I don't remember, I mean, in past years, I don't remember ever hearing anything about the North. You know, I mean, you turn on cable news and it's all about the southern border with Mexico all day, every day. But for some reason here in New Hampshire, all of a sudden we're hearing about the northern border. And I don't remember this being a thing to this degree before. So what's driving this? Why now?
I mean, curious Sebastian's thoughts, but, you know, it's politics and it's, you know, how do they get votes and how do
it's
they other people?
It's election season.
And so it's really disappointing. You know, when we heard from, you know, from folks up in the North Country that they needed housing, broadband, that they needed living wage. And yet our state decided to put $1.4 million into a Northern Border Alliance program to address an issue that does not exist. And so I think it's deeply concerning that we're wasting that kind of money, but also expanding policing and surveillance. And I think, you know, one of the other really concerning aspects is at the same time, our Governor Sununu has asked the Biden administration to grant a waiver for what's called a 287G agreement so that New Hampshire law enforcement can engage in what is, in effect, federal immigration enforcement. So a 287G agreement is an agreement between either local or state and or state law enforcement and the federal government that basically deputizes local or state law enforcement to engage in federal immigration enforcement.
Which is so scary. As an immigrant myself, just think about, you know, my local police, can enforce immigration duties and kind of, you know, not do their work. To me, that's scary. You know, what about emergencies? What about, you know, car accidents, traffic stops, but you're going to be able to stop me with on an immigration basis. But what's your training? You know, on what basis you're going to detain me? Because I look different, I sound different. So that's where that concerns are. What's going to happen is going to create some kind of, tension between community and local law enforcement.
Okay.
And I think that's well documented. And I think, you know, our concern too is we're hearing that there's this crisis that we have to expand policing and surveillance because of this crisis. It's all about quote unquote public safety. And when you actually, if you actually look at this issue through a quote public safety lens and actually look at the data, it's clear. There have been numerous surveys that have looked at the effect of deputizing local police to engage in federal immigration enforcement. What they found consistently is that when you give local police that power, it actually makes the communities less safe. And why does it do it? Because people who are either undocumented or may live with undocumented family members or have undocumented loved ones are less likely to go to the police when they're a victim of a crime or a witness of a crime.
Right.
And so what they're in effect doing, the folks who are pushing this, is making us all less safe. And so not only is it a waste of money, but it's undermining community safety. It's driving a further wedge between law enforcement and the communities they're supposed to serve and build trust with. And all this is being done based off of rhetoric, which is just deeply, deeply troubling.
Which in all honesty, is the whole relationship is really damaged. You know, we have seen what happened with people of color and police all over the country. So I think this will just add more fuel to the fire.
This has been done in some states, right? Because I seem to remember hearing this a few years ago in the news where this was an issue.
Yeah, it's been done in a number of states, and surprisingly, a number of states, localities are actually moving away from these 287G agreements because of what I mentioned about this is undermining community trust in law enforcement. So I recently was in South Carolina at the ACLU in South Carolina for a couple of years and working on immigration issues. And so Charleston County, the largest county in South Carolina, you know, this is deep red South Carolina. Mm-hmm. Ended their 287G agreement with the feds because it was undermining community safety. The sheriff came out and said, this is not the kind of agreement. This is not what I want to do as a sheriff. This is making my community less safe. This is driving a wedge between my deputies and the communities that we're supposed to serve. And so Charleston's not alone. There have been a number of localities in the deep South that have ended 287G agreements. And yet we have our governor here trying to double down on this racist and kind of counterproductive policy.
It actually surprises me that he's doing that. I didn't know about that. I had no idea. So what happens practically? So he asks the Biden administration. So that has to come from the executive branch?
So the Department of Homeland Security would have to grant the waiver for a new 287. So the Biden administration, I don't remember specifically when, but a little while back, put a moratorium on new 287G agreements. And so for DHS to grant one to New Hampshire law enforcement, they would have to grant that waiver.
Okay.
And so that's something Sebastian, Rights and Democracy, ACLU, a number of our immigrant rights coalition partners are trying to warn against, because not only is it, you know, further driving a wedge between and making our communities less welcoming, but it's also making our communities less safe.
And then the a practical effect of this would be, so if someone is who is undocumented, say, for example, and they do report a crime, and then they're interacting with law enforcement, a member of law enforcement could check their immigration status, and then if they're flagged, and if they're flagged, then what? Would local law enforcement then take that individual into custody, or would they contact the feds? Like, what happens then?
They could take into custody, contact the feds, and that person would then go into the immigration detention system, which is absolutely horrific.
Yeah, yeah.
Lengthy, horrific, nerve-wracking for the families, for everyone.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I can see how that would be a big problem. I didn't know that was happening here, or that our governor was trying to do that.
Just imagine what 1.4 million can do, in northern New Hampshire, we have opioid epidemic up north. We have a housing affordability.
Mm-hmm.
1.4 million can go a long way.
Right.
But trying to put that much money on immigration, an immigration crisis that doesn't exist.
Yeah.
I think it's just pure election politics, because immigration, bad immigration sells, people go to the polls because they think they're being threatened by immigrants crossing the border. So when the fact is the opposite.
Right.
I think immigrants enrich New Hampshire and contribute to the well-being of this nation. And the messaging, that's the type of messaging we're trying to change. Narrative.
Yeah. If you'd like to get in with a call, we do have a little bit of time left in today's show. 603-250-6007, 603-250-6007. We have Sebastian and Frank here, and we're having a great discussion about immigration and some of the challenges around it. And Crystal, our friend from Illinois, said in the chat room, every single one of us comes from immigrants unless you are of indigenous descent. All of our descendants came from somewhere else. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. What about, so, well, Frank, let me put the question to you, because Sebastian and I were talking earlier about, you know, simplifying the visa system and things like that. I mean, do you have thoughts on solutions? Because it can be very discouraging, right? Because people tend to like, you know, bumper sticker solutions or things that fit on a t-shirt, like, you know, build the wall or something like that. Which, and again, as I was telling Sebastian earlier, in terms of, you know, the southern border with Mexico, for example, you know, I don't have a problem with, you know, the idea of making the border more secure. I think as a sovereign nation, we have a right to know who's coming in and out of the country. And you know, we should have a legal process that's accessible for that, which we do. But there are a lot of people coming over the border. But I think that, you know, comprehensive immigration reform is what we really need the most. I don't know. I mean, do you have thoughts on that as in terms of what we should be doing in terms of solutions, or maybe, I don't know, maybe you're as cynical about it as I am, because I feel like, like we don't make any progress, you know? Yeah. Some wall gets built, but we don't make any progress whatsoever on the actual system itself.
Obviously we share concerns that this is an issue that needs to be addressed and addressed at the federal level. Our national office has been working on this issue for a long time. And so they've been working, you know, in the weeds, you know. Obviously, you know, a while back, we thought that there was going to be an agreement back with Lindsey Graham and others, I think, what, 10, 12 years ago.
Oh, was that the Gang of Six or the Gang of Eight? Yeah.
So this is an issue that's been long in the works. And our national office has been working on this for a while and obviously deeply, deeply committed to the work.
Yeah. I remember when Senator Marco Rubio of Florida, he was involved. I can never remember. You know, whenever it's a bipartisan thing, they call it a gang, the Gang of Six or Gang of Eight or Gang of Ten or whatever. And I remember in 2016, he was a part of that. And they were really trying to do something good, you know, and then it just didn't work out. And then it's like the guy, this is my complaint about him. It's like he wakes up one day and says, oh, wait a minute, I have a Republican nomination to win. I can't have anything to do with this trying to reform immigration. You know what I mean? And then at the debates in 2016, he's like acting like he was never a part of it. Like, what? I didn't say we should have immigration reform. What are you talking about? I mean, it's so hard to get anything done on that. And it's very frustrating. I'll ask both of you guys, do you have any thoughts on the border itself, the southern border, in terms of should we be building more wall? You know, the president apparently, very bizarre mixed message coming out of Biden today about, yeah, well, we are going to build some more wall, but I'm just doing it because I have to. Sorry, walls don't work. And then Secretary Mayorkas is saying, well, actually, no, there are sections that, you know, we probably should build some wall. And it's just a jumbled mess. I mean, I complain a lot about Democrats are very often very bad at messaging. What should we be doing, guys, with all that in terms of securing the border? Should we secure the border? I'll ask both of you, whoever wants to go first.
I think we need to do a study of the reasons why, the root causes of why people are migrating from countries like south of Venezuela. I think we know what's happening down there, what's happening in Honduras, Mexico. You know, I helped so many families that came to New Hampshire from Honduras that were victims of not even gun violence, but his own military violence towards them, you know, because they are pretty well connected to drug cartels. So are those people have a valid reason to come to this country for safety? Yes. I also understand there's some folks that shouldn't be here. Mm-hmm. You know, I completely am aware of that, but they should be, reinforce the staffing levels at the southern border. Mm-hmm. We should make sure that we can create centers of where they can do those processes faster.
Yeah.
And by doing it faster, also doing it in a responsible way.
Yeah.
We need to increase the amount of people that will be able to handle immigration cases, judges, lawyers, immigration lawyers in the U.S. is kind of a weak point.
Mm-hmm.
But I think by doing that and also reinserting the messaging of the immigration system in the U.S. needs to go back to be a humane system,
mm-hmm.
of respect, of also understanding why they're coming and how can we help those nations, because many of the reasons why they came here is because of international economic policies that this country has inflicted into those nations. So we have to come to the realization that they're not coming here just because they want to.
Right.
You know, people from Venezuela, if you're going to walk from Venezuela with your child in your back for a better life, I want you here, because that's a challenge. Mm-hmm. That's a huge step that you're going to take for the safety of your family. Then I want you here.
Right.
Because it's such a task.
Yeah.
Think about it. I can even barely go 2 walks on the street right now and I'm tired, but coming all the way down there and seeking for a better life, I think that's something that should be, we should reflect on,
mm-hmm.
because like one of the, I mean, the Crystal online mentioned, you know, we are all descendants of immigrants.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we are here for a reason. Irish, Italian, you know, Chinese, whatever you're from, we are all descendants of immigrants. And this is what makes this nation amazing, what mm-hmm. it is right now.
Mm-hmm.
Regardless of its problems, regardless of politics, this is the United States of America, one of the most powerful country. We should be able to fix this issue in mm-hmm. a more humane and responsible way.
Yeah, well, agreed. Well said. Frank, do you have anything to add to that?
No, I agree with Sebastian. I think in the absence of comprehensive immigration reform, we've also seen a race to the bottom between the two parties. And so it's like doubling down on who can be harsher, who can be more militaristic, who can be more about surveillance, and forgetting that this is about basic humanity. And so I think we do need to get back to that. We need to realize that, you know, we are spending obscene amounts of money on the enforcement side of things when we can be investing that money into our communities to make our communities, I mean, we know from evidence what makes our community safer. It is access to housing, it is living wage. And so if we were actually to take the billions and billions and billions of dollars that we're pouring into both our immigration enforcement side and also into our policing practices and actually invest that into evidence-based programs like housing, like living wage, we would actually make our communities safer.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think we need to really reclaim the narrative of public safety in our communities and recognize that it's, you know, public safe and just communities are access to housing, access to transportation, access to quality education, access to living wage, food security, safe environment. All of those things make our communities safer. And instead, we're pouring, you know, billions and billions of dollars in the southern border into expanded policing and surveillance, militarization. Now that rhetoric is coming to the northern border. We're seeing it both at the federal level and then now at the Northern Border Alliance at the state level. And so we need to kind of take a step back, recognize that that is not what we should be doing as a nation. We should be investing that money into our people, and that'll make us all safer.
And also, too, I mean, the time goes so quick, but I'll ask both of you. Can you each give me briefly an example of something that you hear a lot or you see a lot that people completely misunderstand about immigration, just in a broad sense, whether it's kind of the demonization of immigrants, which drives me insane, or just anything that you can think of that you hear or you see a lot that's just wrong, that where people just have a I'll throw one out there. So some people will say that, oh, people come to this country illegally, these immigrants come in, whether they're coming here illegally or whether they're asylum seekers, and they're just given all this stuff, you know, while Americans who are already here, are left starving and homeless. But, oh, these immigrants, they come in and they're just given everything, and then they don't pay any taxes, which, of course, is ridiculous. Because people don't realize, I'm going to rant again, but people don't understand that you cannot exist in this country without contributing to the economy,
right,
and contributing to the tax base. When people say, oh, these people come in and they don't contribute anything, they're describing something that's physically impossible. You literally cannot exist within the borders of the United States without actively contributing to the economy and contributing to the tax base. It would be impossible. So that's mine. Sebastian, do you have one?
No, I just agree with what you're saying. Okay. You know, you work, you're paying taxes.
Yeah.
But many of those immigrants, especially those undocumented folks that are doing the work in the farm fields or factories all around the country, they don't get taxes. They don't get taxes back.
Right.
They don't collect benefits. They cannot collect food stamps. They cannot do any of that stuff. So,
exactly.
That was one of those. And the other one is, like, you know, immigrants are coming here and taking our jobs. You know, there's many jobs there that are available right there for everyone. And many, many people don't want to take them because they are, you know, a subpar wages type of job, you know, dishwashing or working in the field. I challenge folks to be out in California in 100 degree weather trying to pick up tomatoes on a hot day in summer.
Yep.
You know, for $7.25 an hour. Will you do it? And your shift is 12-hour day.
Right.
You know, and those folks want to do it because they want to make the money.
Exactly.
And then some of them stay in the area, some of them go back to Mexico and support their family. So I think that's some one of the messaging that I've been trying to like push to change in just in my community, even in my own family members.
Yeah.
Because whatever you see on the news, some many people think that's true. And it's not right.
And by the way, isn't it bizarre that while we're sitting at 3.5% unemployment and then it doesn't seem like that's going to change, that there's actually people who will still say, almost out of habit, like they're just automatons, they'll say, oh, they're coming here to take all our jobs. What jobs?
Right.
We don't have enough people for these jobs to begin with. What job are they taking from you? There's too many jobs and not enough people to fill them as it is. It's just crazy. Frank, do you have one?
Yeah, and I think the other piece, too, is that, you know, we've come to this rhetoric of, you know, when we talk about immigration, you know, people go to think crime. Mm-hmm. And so we hear this rhetoric around the northern border that there's this crisis at the border, that it's creating this crime wave. And so actually, before this conversation, I pulled the most recent information from the Department of Safety around crime offenses in both Colebrook and Pittsburgh. And so I pulled the last 4 years of data. Colebrook went from 79 total offenses in 2018 to 77 in 2021, so decrease in crime.
Yeah.
Pittsburgh went from 9 total offenses in 2018 to 13 in 2021.
Okay.
So the notion that somehow, you know, there's this crisis at the border that it's creating crime again is not backed by any actual facts. And
yeah.
So I think that's what we're really trying to do with our work with Rights and Democracy and others, is to get this back to the facts. There is no quote-unquote crisis at the northern border. There is no uptick in crime. And in fact, statewide overall crime since bail reform in 2018 is down 18%.
Yeah.
And so this notion that this is making us less safe is just not serious.
Yeah, yeah. Excellent. We are, we're just about out of time. Sebastian, where should people go online to find you, get involved in what you're doing, and a website, anything you want us to know about?
No, yeah. I just want to first just, to your listeners out there, I'm glad that we're having this conversation right
yes.
in the middle of Hispanic Heritage Month.
Yes,
you know?
Yes.
So I want to invite the listeners out there to just engage with your Hispanic neighbors, you know, enjoy the food, enjoy the music, enjoy the company, because this is a moment to a month for us to celebrate, but also to reflect of, you know, on issues on immigration as well. You can find me on www.ratmovement.org. I'm the political director for Rights and Democracy. We're having a healthcare rally next week here in Manchester, New Hampshire, from 3 to 6. We're going to start at Pulaski Park. Everybody's invited. And yeah, if I can be of any assistance or help, you want to have a good conversation about any topic here in New Hampshire, let me know.
Excellent.
I'm there for you.
Excellent. We will do this again. And by the way, Jenny's going to be a part of that event.
Absolutely.
At Pulaski Park. Frank, what should we know? Resources, people you want people to know about online?
Oh, definitely. So if you want to learn more about the ACLU of New Hampshire and our priorities, just go to our website, www.aclu-nh.org.
All right. Very good. Gentlemen, I wish we had more time, but thank you both. This has been, I think, a great discussion, and I hope to have you both on in the future. This has been wonderful. There's probably a million things we could talk about that we didn't get to. So thank you again, and I'll just remind everybody, too, I'll be back tonight for Retro Spectrum Radio with Paulie C. live from 8 to 11 p.m. here at WMNH. And if you miss any part of today's show, it will be up in just a little bit at WMNHradio.org. And at my website, mattconnerton.com. And that's going to do it for us for now. We're out. I'll talk to y'all a little bit later. Bye, everybody.